I want to jump right into this because I've got a ton of questions and probably somebody I can talk to forever, probably just about anything, is Steve Giordano. And if you don't know who he is, you have not been on any FFL Facebook page ever because he was the number one producer last year. And he's not only the number one producer this year, but I believe you're at right now, year to date, you're at issue paid what right now?
770.
I believe the FFL highest issue paid ever was like 748. Is that right? You think that's right?
Yeah, that's what Jonathan did last year.
Yeah, right on there. And he took 12 months, and he's good. Do you know what it is right now? It's not December. It's July, and you're at 770. It's just nuts. You know, and the best part about this is if you guys know Steve, and I've got to know him a little bit, he's just a good dude. And if you watch his training, everything he does and everything he goes over is so relatable. You know, we tend to overcomplicate this business, and a lot of times it paralyzes us because we think we need to know everything and there's got to be some kind of secret sauce for the top producers. Like I would think if I just came into this business that Steve had either more hours in a day or more days in the week than the rest of us. But when you talk to him and you hear how he does the sales process, you truly get a feeling that all of us can do this. Now, he's doing something right because he's the only one that is. You know, there's Steve and then there's second place, which is way below him. So I know he's got a great work ethic. But I want to start off with, you know, you're on pace for $1.2 million for the year.
All right. Yeah, I think so. Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, right around there. So now I know some of this information, and I know we only have a little bit of time to go over this, but I want to start back. So I know that you did come into this business in September of 18. Is that right?
Yeah, I got my license in September of 18. I actually didn't have my first appointment until it was Thanksgiving weekend of 2018.
Okay, so about 2 months later then. Okay.
Yeah, and it was part-time.
How did you find is Family First? So Family First Life is your first stop in insurance, right? You have no insurance before here. Now, how did we find you?
So Mark Mead was a friend of mine back. Probably I met him in probably 2010, 2011, and I had been dabbling into the thought of doing insurance. I had a guy who sold me an IUL back in 2015, and he was talking to me about, you know, coming on with his company, and it intrigued me, and I really, you know, liked the product and everything, you know, what it did, and I was intrigued about having my own business, but I just didn't have kind of the guts to do it. And then, you know, in talking to Mark, I saw what he was doing. He was talking to me a little bit about football or whatever it was, and then he was telling me what he was doing with insurance. And I was like, okay, like I kind of felt like it was time for me to make a move out of the hospitality industry. So ironically enough, when I moved to Florida in 2016, there was another gentleman who was a partner of the guy who sold me the IUL. And I was talking to him, and then I'm talking to Mark, and Mark's like, look, they don't have leads and we do. Come here, you know me, and you trust me. And the rest is really history, as they say.
So warm market, which is what anybody that's building an agency, we always tell them to hit up the warm market. We don't tell them to hit them up in a way that you're bothering people at barbecues, birthday parties, and that sort of thing. But just letting people know what it is that you do. And, you know, you just happen to know somebody who's phenomenal at what we do. Yeah. You know, one of the pioneers of the company, one of the people that built this from the ground up, Mark Mead. And so your background, obviously not in insurance, you said hospitality. What exactly were you doing when you first got involved here?
So I had my whole career from when I was 15. I worked in restaurants. I was running restaurants and multiple restaurants. And it was kind of like the type of thing where you were running the business, but you weren't really running the business, you know? Like, so it kind of was getting to a point where I was like, all right, I know I want to do my own thing and be my own boss, but I just didn't really, you know, how to do it. And I didn't have the vehicle.
Okay. So when you got your license, started running your first appointment in November. Okay. And I know this is a little while ago, not too far back. What was your mindset when you first started? Now, it's a little bit different animal because obviously with the hospitality and not being self-employed, you never had to invest in yourself. So what was your approach to leads when you very first started? And then how do you grow that approach to have in your first full year be number one overall in the company? Well, you're number one or number two? You're number two, right?
I was number two.
That's right. Yeah.
It's interesting because when I bring on new agents now that are coming in part-time, I always refer back to that November, December, January when I was working a full-time job and I was trying to train and I was literally just going out of 24 hours because I wanted the transition and I wanted this to work. And I started running appointments just, you know, a couple nights here and there. And then on Saturdays, like I'd run like all day Saturday. So, you know, you're working your, you know, 6 days a week, 6.5 days a week, whatever it was. But I said to myself kind of going in, if I can work really, really hard this couple of months and see some success, it's going to give me the belief that I can leave my full-time job and be, you know, comfortable in my decision. So, you know, lead wise right out the gate, I was doing, you know, $500 final expense, those couple of weekends, you know, pretty much every week, every other week. And then that kind of took me to convention. And then convention is when, I really, really saw the belief. And I remember leaving convention and just saying, okay, you have to make this now work. And then I got home from convention and I remember, I say this story to all my new agents, I put out about probably 4,000 elites. You know, Mark had called me, he said, hey, there's this area up in Northern Florida, there's some mortgage. And I was so stupid, I did not understand or believe the concept of dropping mail, right? Like, and now I'm to the point where I'm like, you can't drop enough mail for me.
But yeah.
At that point, I was like, wait a minute. So I'm going to spend $1,200. They're going to mail things and I'm going to pray that it comes back. I just didn't get it. But I trusted them. Again, going back to your warm market theory. So I did that. I invested in EverQuote. They matched. And I knew I'd get a lot of leads out of that. And that would stretch me for a few months. And then, you know, I added, you know, my final expense every week. So right out the gate, I did about 4,000 for that first month. And then that took me to like a $21,000 initial full-time month in March.
So that, first of all, the first thing I hear there is that you had a belief in somebody else. You know, you had a belief with Mark that he's not going to steer you wrong. He's not going to have you invest in something that's not going to have a return on it. And he's one of the best in the industry. So he knows a lot about this and what it takes. And I think that that seems to be one of the biggest issues with getting new agents going, is having them buy into that same belief, because there's so many agents that come in and they make that initial $500 investment into leads. And if it doesn't go perfectly, then they're like, well, hey, I spent $500. I don't want to do this again. Well, a minimum purchase of leads is going to produce minimum results. That's what you're going to get out of that. And so, you know, you had your initial investment, decided if I were to really make this work, I want to pour this on and put 4,000 into that. So even if you put $100 into leads and someone gave you $150 back, you still come out ahead. You just need to do that more and more and more. And so the other thing I hear in that is that you had the mailers, so your mail-in leads. Then you did EverQuote, which is, you know, the internet leads, and then final expense. And so you had a wide variety of leads that you were purchasing there. Talk to me about your schedule early on. So did you quit your job at this time, or are you still working full time?
Yeah, so I was, it was November, December, January to that first week of February, part-time. And then it was literally going into convention. I had left my job and I was like, all right, you're all in, you know, you're full-time from there in February. My schedule at the time, you know, I said this to Mark early on and he always leans on it. I said, you know, look, there's no way I'm going to believe that I'm going to work not as hard as I did when I worked for someone as I am right now as my own boss. So I kind of took that mentality. And then I also ran with 30 appointments to the point that I am brainwashed. Every week, I am going to run 30 appointments. Nothing else really matters. That is legitimately my only goal because I know what it will bring. Like you can't, you know, like, you don't have to be magical. You just have to consistently run it. So, you know, I just followed the schedule, the Monday, Thursday dial, running, you know, 15 appointments on Tuesday, Wednesday, Friday, Saturday. And I've pretty much done that the entire time.
So when you first came on board and you invest in leads, and what training did you lean on to get prepared to go out there and go into houses, which is something that was pretty foreign to you at that time? What, is there any videos that you watched, training that you watched, people that you followed? I mean, obviously you have, you know, Mark by your side to help you out as well too. But what did you focus on early on to get prepared to go into houses?
Yeah, great question. It was, I engulfed myself into the training. You know, as I was kind of in that September getting my license and looking at where I was headed with this, I remember listening to like Monday morning wake-up calls and all the stuff that was on the podcasts. And I really just invested a lot of time into just anything that there was, call to close, all that stuff. I just was like, okay, I'm going to listen and listen and listen and listen, because that's the only way I am going to be good at this and get over the learning curve. So I just really, when they say all in, like, it's really true. I went all in the sense that I just engulfed my time with either training or then activity of whether it be dialing or running appointments. So anything and everything. And what's so amazing is now, even going back when I, you know, started over a year and a half ago, the training is probably triple now with more Facebook groups, more Zoom calls. Like, you know, you'd have to be blind to not see all the training.
So let me ask you this. So you came in, you issued like just under 700 your first full year, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And then 770 now. So basically in a year and a half, you know, 1.5 million. How much did you have to invent or reinvent or do on your own versus how much did you just follow the process that somebody else laid before you?
I invented zero. A big fat zero. Nothing.
Yeah.
I literally just list. I was like, okay, like Matt Smith is really good at this. You're really good at this. Mark is really good at this. Okay, let me put my spin on, you know, connecting with a client and a personality and being tenacious and having hard work. Let me just put that behind the rocket ship of all the people that have laid all this information right out in front of me that's at my fingertips.
Yep, and so I keep telling people that if everyone was as smart as me, we'd still be hunting with rocks and eating berries. That's funny. I am not a pioneer in any way whatsoever, but I can follow what somebody else is doing that's successful at it. I think that's awesome. And I think that a lot of people just try, because we do have people coming from other organizations now. A lot of them have some experience and stuff, and they try and put their own personal spin on things and change the way we're doing things and change this phone script. And do the. It's all so simple and it's all available to us. I mean, there's endless videos on every aspect of what we do. We've been here 6.5 years. We've perfected just about everything. There's really not a whole lot that you can invent here that hasn't been done already. And it's just a matter of buying into it. And I hate to use the word systems because it seems like it's something else, but that's really what it is. I mean, I don't know of another career that you can just walk in. Every single person is an open book and transparent and willing to share what they did with you to help you get to where they are. And that's why I really appreciate you taking the time. I know with as much as you're right, and you have a new baby on the way.
Yep.
Yep. Congratulations on that. And then you're also building a business. So I appreciate you taking the time out to spend with us here.
Cool.
So, you know, in a year with the productivity that you had, now, after you start, you invest in leads, you start running appointments, you issue 21,000, it starts building from there. How did you take, because it happens in the business, but how do you take like the first set of chargebacks that you get? What was your reaction to that and how'd you overcome that?
Okay, the biggest thing that I still need to work on is taking the emotions out of chargebacks. I think, you know, at this point, when you look at things in the numbers and you just say, okay, 20% of people are going to bring the stuff back to Walmart, you know, kind of a deal.
Yep.
If you write enough and you run enough appointments, it doesn't matter. If I write 20,000 and I lose two, you know, am I that mad at it? You know, so do I always handle them 100%? No, I'll be perfectly honest and transparent. But at this point, you're just like, okay, you kind of know what it is. You kind of know how your week's going to go. You do the best you can. But ultimately, even with chargebacks, you're still so ahead of the game. And you're so profitable if you just work and run, you know, a normal schedule. You're ridiculously profitable.
Yep, it doesn't matter. So the one thing I love about everything you're saying here is you're not focused on the results. You're not. It doesn't sound like you're a guy that says, I'm going to go out there. I want to get 100,000 issue paid. I want to get 120,000 issue paid in a month. I'm focused on the activity, and the activity will control the results. And you know that going in. So you know what the end result is going to be just based off the activity that you put in.
Oh, 1,000%. You know, like, it's almost like even saying, like, okay, if I want to have the goal of writing a million, okay, like, great. But I know all the effort and all the schedule and the things that I need to have to just add up to that. If I just do those things repetitively and work really hard, I'm going to hit the goals that I need to hit. There's no doubt about that.
What was the little clip that you sent me? It's buying leads or dialing leads, setting appointments, running appointments, selling insurance. You deal with cancellations too, and you just repeat.
That's on the cycle.
And I think that newer agents coming on board, they get punched in the mouth, and then they sit on the stool and cry a little bit, you know. Yeah. But the sooner that you get, you know, when you get punched in the mouth, the sooner you get back up and start fighting again, then, you know, adrenaline takes over and those punches don't hurt anymore. And you just keep moving forward. And we've all suffered those, you know, this business has some ups and downs. But one of the things I've heard you say before, and, you know, we preach this, is the sooner that you can take the emotions out of any aspect of what we do, the better off you're going to be. And it almost makes it boring, because when you're running appointments, it's not so much, I'm so good at this, I just sold that person because I'm so good at this. You have to take the highs and the lows out of it. And you just almost have to be just methodical about what you do. Go run your 30 appointments and the end results are going to be there. So I have seen you some of the in-home training that you do. And I love this because everyone wants to hear from you because of the numbers you put up. And so there's people right now getting their pens ready and they're ready to write down the secrets that you have that nobody else has, right? And then when they hear it, they're like, what? It's just work? Mm-hmm. You know, so I love this part about, you know, you just dialing, going to the appointments. And so walk me through a little bit of what you do in the house, because there's so many agents that get freaked out because they don't know every product. They don't know every carrier. They don't know what to write in each house. And they don't have control or structure in the house either. But all of that is really, really simple if you just narrow it down. So why don't you kind of walk me through what you do in the house, and just say it's mortgage protection. And sometimes you got to pivot on those. I understand that. But walk me through your in-home in just a few minutes there.
Yeah, and I love what you said, just to touch on it. The whole getting punched in the mouth thing, if that is the key to all of this. Like, you have to have a tough jaw and just a tough, thick skin, and then just keep going forward. But, you know, the in-home, the biggest thing for me is structure. You know, you just said the word, and I think that's where sometimes agents will lose, because there's a lot going on in houses. You know, you're going to walk into your houses where it's simplistic and it's easy, and then you're going to walk into the ones that are chaotic, and you have to really kind of reel everything in. So, you know, for me, I will always lead to the table, being respectful, and all of my rapport building is kind of built on the way as we walk. So I'm kind of methodical and just, you know, having the conversations, and I like to rapid fire questions to clients, you know, in a way for me to get information that I need, as well as us to kind of connect. How long have you lived in Florida? Where are you from originally? You know, what did you do for work? Are you retired? Blah, blah, blah. Get into a little bit about kids' beneficiaries, because now I kind of trigger that a little bit. And then I'll just let them know right out the gate, and I'll keep it simple. And I'll say, there's two objectives I have with every client. One, we're going to figure out where you're going to get approved contingent on your health. And number two, what's going to make the best financial sense for you today, tomorrow, and forever. And then, you know, I will show my card, say how I do mortgage protection, retirement planning, and yada, yada, yada. And I jump right into it. Ever anything major, stroke, cancer, heart attack, anything big, I'm jotting that down. Medications, anything there, anything you're taking. Then I'll get into, you know, obviously the spouse, if there's a spouse. Then on a mortgage, okay, so we have your mortgage is $300,000. What is the value of your house? Because on the ones that are, and let's face it, we have a lot of these, someone that might not be getting your traditional term, that might be getting a whole life or multiple whole life, I want to leverage the equity that they probably have if I have to go the equity protection route. I'm also big on not playing my hand, where I'm not going to sit there and talk to you about living benefits and all these magical things if you are 67 and have, you know, COPD or have had heart issues, because then you're dead man walking, because now I've sold you something you can't get. So I think one of the keys to issue paying a lot is submitting good business and selling people on what they can get as opposed to what they want, which is not the easiest thing always. So now I have the information on the mortgage, ask the golden question, what do you have that acts like life insurance that will, you know, pay out tomorrow if something happens? So I can gauge there what I have for, you know, potential annuities, of which I need to be a lot better at because I don't write that many. So I'm figuring that out, that financial picture. Then I will dive into, you know, beneficiary, talk a little bit there, get a little emotional for them, you know, kids or spouse, whatever. Then I dive into the budget. And this is a key for me, because I say a lot of things about how I want this to make financial sense, because I don't want to come across as the guy who's just selling you the most expensive thing on the block. I want this to fit your budget. I want it to fit your budget today during COVID-19, understanding that we can readjust this in 6 months to a year. But the key is that we cover you today. So I'll dive into it. And it also helps me because now I've killed objections as far as what I can and can't afford. If you tell me at the end of that budget and we agree that you have an extra $500 a month and I show you, you know, $300, $250, $150, there's nowhere for you to hide. Then you're flat out telling me that whatever, like, you just don't want it, which is fine. But at least I know and I get agreement there. So then, you know, based on the health, then that's where I'm going to look at, you know, if it's your HMS, on a lot of the younger clients, I'm usually selling on the 25-year selling that, paying house off early, or in a lot that I've had recently, people that don't have retirement. And then that CBO comes in, bang, you're getting all this money back. I've had ones where the loan is like $100,000 and I show them $100,000, but then I show them $300,000 and I say, you don't have a retirement. Look at what this number is going to be if we go on the $300,000. I've had a few, it would have been a $50 policy, now it's a $150 or whatever. Yeah. On the reverse, if it's you know, unhealthy, whole life critical period coverage, talking about, you know, what that does, buying time. This is going to give you X amount of months of mortgage payments. This is why this makes financial sense, getting agreements, you know, a lot of the Matt Smith stuff that he does so well. If I have your older 60 to 75 year old, I might go the HMS 100 route and spin it on living benefits and giving you 15, 20 years of 100,000 of living benefits. That's going to cover maybe a half or a third of your loan, but it's going to give you living benefits. And then I'll spin it into, do you have long-term care? This is going to kind of help you there if you get an illness and yada, yada, yada. So I kind of make a lot of those determinations in the house based on health, number one, because again, I want to submit business that's going to get issued. I don't want to sell you on a hope and a dream and then we get the client. So that's pretty much the way I structure it. And then I'll show with quotes, you know, I'll have, you know, three different quotes I'll show to not overcomplicate. And I'll just say flat out, which one of these makes the best financial sense for you? What do you feel comfortable with? I'll show something really high and then I'll show the middle ground and the low ground. And usually the low ground is still pretty good. You know, if I show you 375 and 250 and 180, I'm not mad if you get 180.
Not at all. Yeah. What I love about that is that you did such a great job of explaining how you work and how you show what the coverage is going to do for them, not just the cost, not just her, because a lot of people make this transactional. They're like, okay, you get X amount of coverage for this many dollars. Well, you go above and beyond to show them whether it's going to be be critical care coverage, to supplement their retirement. You show them what that's going to do for them. And oh, by the way, this is what it costs. Because a lot of newer agents, and even agents that are out there for a while, everything they do is transactional. You know, they don't show what the coverage is actually going to do. They don't show that it's going to give them, you know, 3 to 5 years worth of payments in the bank to make a, you know, a decision after, well, after their loved one has passed away, or or to use the living benefits to supplement, you know, long-term care, because they don't have that. And they have a tax-free pool of money to pull from if they do get diagnosed with cancer, heart attack, stroke, that sort of thing. And I think that, you know, Matt always says this, that, you know, people buy when value exceeds price. Well, the only way that value is going to exceed price is when we show them the value and what this is going to do for them. And so you just laid it out perfectly. I love this because this is all stuff that, you know, anyone on here listening, a brand new agent can take this out there and just go start selling insurance right away. The other thing that I picked up on in talking to you is you're very assumptive. When I haven't heard you on the phone, I'm assuming you're assumptive on the phone as well too, but you're assumptive going into the houses. Like, they ask for this information. My job is to find something they see the value and they can afford and they're going to buy. So go into how you approach this with a little bit of assumptiveness too.
Yeah, one of the funnest things I love about doing this is, and I saw this in an entrepreneurial post somebody posted, people focus on making money when they need to focus on solving problems. Because if you focus on solving problems, you'd make a ton of money. So I enjoy looking at a scenario and then on the spot, on the fly, saying, I think XXX plan and blah, blah, blah is going to fit the gap. And I'll go one further on kind of my appointments. I've had a lot of this lately where you meet that older client that has like that kind of IUL that eats itself alive. You know, like I had one the other day, the guy's got 8,000 in it in March. Now he's got 6,000. He tells me, I pay 100 a month. Yes, you do pay 100 a month, but your cost of insurance, you're actually paying double. You're paying 200 a month in cost of insurance. So now it went from 8 to 6, and then look at where it's headed. So now that's like another chip in my corner to say, we're going to stop the bleeding there and we're going to put this here. And this is going to be a rock solid plan for you long term, you know? So kind of some of that stuff I love to do. And, you know, the assumptiveness is just, hey, you filled out looking for insurance and I'm here to get you insurance.
Mm-hmm.
You fill this out because you have a problem and I'm the doctor. So
let's, and
if we don't, it's weird to me. It's
just, I love that.
Why am I here?
One other thing is, I know that you do a really great job at the financial inventory. And, you know, the financial inventory is painting a picture of what's going to happen when, whether it's one person's going to die or one of the two is going to die. What do you identify and what do you focus on to build that value on the financial inventory?
A big thing with husband and wife is the Social Security dynamic of educating them on, okay, you know, Mary, you get 800 and Bob, he gets, you know, 1200. Do you realize you're losing 800? And then I'll multiply that and I'll say, okay, you know, now you're going to lose almost 10 grand a year. So I like to kind of paint that picture. I love to paint the picture of loss. When you paint the picture of loss, then what you are filling the gap with, it just makes even more financial sense. So I think that's a big, big key in the financial inventory, and it's a part of your budget. And I think it also lends you credibility to when I'm sitting there telling you that I do financial, you know, retirement planning or whatever, it lends me credibility that I kind of know a little of what I'm doing. And I'm not just the guy, like you had said, who's walking in, you know, oh my God, you're 73 and your loan is 350,000. And I'm going to try and magically, you know, cover that for 4 grand a month. Cause it's not going to happen. So you have to kind of get creative with the financial picture, because fact of the matter is you can spin something that makes financial sense for any scenario of any age.
Yep. Absolutely. And I think that, you know, just to wrap this up, so you're at 770 for the year, okay? And you do all these things that are so simple as far as, you know, having a tight schedule, dialing your leads every Monday, Thursday, you dial until you have your 30 appointments set, you run those appointments, and the end results are what they are. There's no magic pill here. There's no secret sauce or anything like that. You build value in every home. You use the financial inventory. And just getting back to what you were just saying there is, a lot of times when we use that financial inventory, that is a lot of times the first time that a couple has ever saw on paper what the income situation is going to be when one of them passes away. And a lot of times it's a slap in the face because they don't think of it that way. Like what I used to do is show them the combined household income now and then the individual incomes when one of them passes away and look at those household bills that aren't going to get any less and say, how are you going to afford this? You know, and the truth of the matter is they can't, you know, and so that helps them build that emotion in. But a lot of times, you know, by us going there, and that's why, you know, a lot of newer agents, I keep referring back to newer agents because they think that the client is doing them a favor by letting them into the house. Well, it's the other way around. You know, we're doing them a favor by bringing our professionalism there. We're the only licensed agent in the room, typically. If we're not, that's weird. You know, and sometimes we have a conversation that they should have, but just don't know that they should and haven't yet. And we look at the reality of what life's going to look like when one passes away. And so, you know, I never wanted to be in insurance sales. But once I got into this, I realized that how rewarding it actually is, you know, and how many people we help. You just happen to help a lot more people than the rest of us do. So we all want to be Steve Giordano. And now also, you know, I'm going to end it with this. So now here's a great part about this. Now, you know, you're vice president, health and wealth. You're developing your own agency now. And so a lot of people say, well, hey, I'm going to take some time off of appointments because I'm building an agency. Well, here you have someone who's a top producer in the nation and still building. How do you keep that schedule of doing both at the same time?
Never sleep. No, I'm just kidding. I think, one, I have, you know, Margo, who's really come on and kind of directed some things, and have a recruiter. I'm looking for another potential staff member. So I think it's just a matter of working full days in between your appointments, talking to new agents. What I really am happy and proud of is we kind of built a good system where when we're bringing agents in, we built a website, which is really cool, where you have, you know, resources there. We have a Slack channel, so we're getting all these agents kind of engaged. And now it's almost like you're leaning on the system, right? So now if I can just pour more people into it, I have like a lot of these things that are resources for people that they can lean on. And then I can kind of double back. So like, I'll give an example. We do now live dials, which I never did and didn't want to do. And I saw the value because I started talking to some people. So now we do those. We get some pretty good participation on those. Then we have a training call on Mondays that we do. Myself and Rob Richmond, we kind of partnered up. So now we're getting a lot of traction there. We have the website. We have the Slack. We lean on the serve the people. So now when I have a new agent and they're buying leads, they're following that system. Then when they call me, there's far less questions. So yep. It makes the tight amount of time that I have, it helps, you know? Yep. So I don't have to explain every single thing every single time. It's like, hey, did you check out this on the website? Oh, you didn't? Cool. Check it out. Watch this video. Then give me a call, and then we'll rap about it for a couple of minutes. And I, you know, I stole that from a Dominique Rogers training that he did the other day.
Yeah.
But it's just a way to kind of be more efficient. Like, it's kind of the way I run. Like, I want to be really, really efficient in the field. So now I kind of want to take the same thing into, you know, building and growing the agency.
That's awesome. Hey, I really do appreciate your time today. You know, we'll all be following you, the first $1 million man here. And it's crazy that you'll probably hit it by October. In all honesty, it couldn't happen to a better guy. You're just a good dude. And everybody likes you. Very likable. Yeah. So we're all pulling for you. Yeah, I really do appreciate you pouring into our team today. Thanks, everybody, for getting on. And we'll see you next week. Thanks again, Steve.
Thank you, brother. It's an honor.
Be back.